stand, the living and the dead. We, your children, whose mortal life is but a hand's breadth, give thanks to you for all those through whom you have blessed our pilgrimage, whose lives have empowered us, whose influence is a healing grace.
We lift up thankful hearts.
For the dear friends and family members whose faces we see no more, but whose love is with us forever.
We lift up thankful hearts.
For the teachers and companions of our childhood and youth, for the members of our household of faith who worship you now in heaven.
We lift up thankful hearts.
For those who sacrifice themselves, our sisters and brothers who have given their lives for the sake of others.
We lift up thankful hearts.
That we may hold them all in continual remembrance and ever think of them as with you in that city whose gates are not shut by day and where there is no night.
We lift up thankful hearts.
That we may now be dedicated to working for a world where labor is rewarded, fear is dispelled, and the nations made one.
O Lord, save your people, bless your heritage. Day by day we magnify you and worship your name forever and ever. Amen.
And now we recognize through the ringing of the chimes the following members, friends, and loved ones who have passed in this past year. Robert Gullick. Faye Winters. Richard A. Anderson, Sr. Pearl Douglas. Lovell Bud Grumley. Max Schneider. Joseph Holloway. Jack Van de Sand. Irene Van de Sand. Robert Semple. And Donna Stork. From honoring just those who had died fighting in the Civil War, to honoring all Americans who died fighting in any war. It is now celebrated every year on the last Monday in May through the National Holiday Act of 1971. Interestingly, since the late 1950s, on the Thursday before Memorial Day, the 1,200 soldiers of the 3rd U.S. Infantry place small American flags on each one of the more than 260,000 gravestones at Arlington National Cemetery. Then they patrol 24 hours a day throughout the weekend to ensure that each flag remains standing. More recently, to help re-educate and remind us of the true meaning of Memorial Day, the National Moment of Remembrance resolution was passed in 2000. It asks all Americans at 3 p.m. local time, and I quote, to voluntarily and informally observe in their own way a moment of remembrance and respect, pausing from whatever they are doing for a moment of silence or listening to taps. And I pray that we all do that tomorrow at 3 p.m. and observe that. So what is it that makes a life worth remembering? Is it heroism? Is it significant accomplishment? Is it fame? How do you see your life? Job said, man born of woman is of few days and full of trouble. And James said, what is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Wow, isn't that encouraging? Thank you, Pastor. I'm ready to leave now. We all want to think that our lives mean something. We want to leave a mark. We want to be remembered by those that we love when we're gone. That's why there are monuments all over our nation for those who gave their lives in battle. That's why we have buildings named after men like Rockefeller, Carnegie, and Ford. That's also why we put markers on the gravestones at the cemetery. Have you ever wondered why we do that? Especially those of us who are people of faith, who believe that that person is not there, and yet we mark that place. Because to us, their memory is sacred, and that is as it should be. But will those things last? Will my life be worth remembering? Will yours? And what is it that will make it memorable? Now, I've asked for some help this morning. Hunter, come on ahead. Hunter is going to read my scripture this morning for us.
When Enoch lived 65 years, he had become the father of Methuselah. And after he became the father of Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Enoch lived 365 years. Enoch walked with God, but then he was no more because God took him away. When Methuselah had lived 187 years, he became the father of Lamech. After he became the father of Lamech, Methuselah lived 782 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Methuselah lived 969 years, and then he died. When Lamech had lived 182 years, he had a son. He named him Noah and said, he will comfort us in the labor and painful toil of our hands caused by the ground the Lord has cursed. After Noah was born, Lamech lived 595 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Lamech lived 777 years, and then he died. After Noah was 500 years old, he became the father of Shem, Ham, and Japheth.
Thank you. Hunter agreed to do that before he knew I had all those names in there. Hunter, you did an excellent job. Thank you. A life worth remembering is built on eternal things. You've just heard Hunter read for us that Methuselah lived 969 years and he died. And that's all we know of Methuselah. He lived 969 years, longer than any other person in the Bible, longer than anybody else that we know of, and yet, all we can say about the man is that he died. And what a tragedy it would be if each one of us got to the end of our lives and somebody was talking about us one day and they said, well, yeah, he died really well. Is that it? Is that all we can say about that person? In fact, here's an interesting thing. I'm jumping ahead just a little bit. I hope you'll all forgive me because I'm going off outline just a smidge. But if you will do the math and you will trace the years of these patriarchs as they are recorded in Genesis 5, there is strong evidence that not only did Methuselah just die, Methuselah may have, in all likelihood, died in the flood. You do the math and trace it through to Noah, his descendant, and you add it all up, it looks like Methuselah might have lived even longer if it hadn't been for the flood, but 969 years and he died. Don't you want to be more than that? Don't you want to be more than a monument in the graveyard? Or just a little word spoken in passing? A life worth remembering is not worth remembering just because it's long. And that's important for us to note here today. Methuselah lived 969 years, and then he died. And that's all Scripture says about him. However, Enoch, Methuselah's father, it says in verse 24 of the text that Hunter read, walked with God. Now that sounds like something we can aspire to. That sounds like something that's desirable, to be able to have it said of us that we walked with God. And then when you look at what the Hebrew word, because of course the book of Genesis was written originally in Hebrew, and so we go back to the original language at times to get a deeper meaning for what the word actually means. The word translated walked in our English Bibles comes from the Hebrew word halak, which is to go, to come with, to follow, or here's the good one, to abide peacefully. Enoch had a relationship with God and lived a life that was characterized by his faith. When his time came to leave, he had walked with God so faithfully and so well that it appears by the scriptural text, Enoch never actually died. God chose to spare him from that ordeal and simply took him to heaven when his time came. And so he didn't have to go through the pain and the suffering and the fear that is often associated with death. But that's not the most remarkable thing about Enoch. The remarkable thing about Enoch is that unlike his son Methuselah, when Enoch died, they were able to say of him, he walked with God. Now, Paul has written this in 1 Corinthians. By the grace God has given me, I laid a foundation as an expert builder, and someone else is building on it. But each one should be careful how he builds, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Christ Jesus. If any man builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, his work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's work. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. And so the only suitable foundation for a life that is worth remembering is Jesus Christ. And when the day comes, if you were looking at that text, which by the way is 1 Corinthians 3, the word day is capitalized. So it's not just any old day, it's the day. It's the day when I stand before my Maker. And he says to me, let's go over your accounts. Let's look over your life. And when he does that, the quality of each one of us individually will be tested. And only that which is built on Christ will survive into eternity and be rewarded. All the other stuff will be burned up, as it says. So we can look at it this way. If you know Christ as your Savior, yes, you will go to heaven when you leave this life. That's a promise of Scripture. But the question becomes, which we used to hear in restaurants a few years ago before the laws changed, do you want smoking or non-smoking? And so we will arrive in heaven as if only barely escaping the flames. Just barely getting by. By just that much grace that Christ has given us. A life worth remembering is worth remembering when it is built on the foundation of Christ and nothing else. Everything else is wood, hay, and stubble that gets burned up in the fire. And then we consider Lamech, Methuselah's son. He doesn't seem all that spectacular. It says in verse 31, he lived 777 years, and then he died. And we could read that and say, well, yeah, okay, whatever. He did the same thing as Methuselah did. Unless, of course, you consider his son Noah. Now, Noah, we know about. We might not know Methuselah. We might not have known Lamech. We might not have even known Enoch unless we have a Sunday school degree. But we know about Noah. Everybody's heard of Noah and the ark in which he built. And Noah, it says in Genesis 6:8, found favor in the eyes of God. How exactly does one find favor in the eyes of God? Well, it follows up in verse 9. Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time, and he walked with God. Why? Because it says in verse 22, he did everything just as God commanded him. Now, allow me to speculate for just a moment. Could it be possibly that Lamech, Noah's father, was such a good father that he was in fact responsible for passing on the characteristics and the traits that Noah was going to need to live as a righteous man when the days were so wicked that God in heaven, the all-loving God, by the way, decided to destroy everybody in a flood except for Noah and his family? Could it be that Noah learned that righteousness sitting at the feet of his father? Could it be that Lamech's heritage, legacy, if you will, is that his son saved all of humanity? You know, that's pretty impressive. That's something you could sit down at Ichiban's and brag about. My son saved everybody. My son survived the flood. My son found favor in the eyes of God. So a life worth remembering, we could say, is worth remembering because it is vested in the ways of God and it is invested in others. So, we could take just two things from that. A life worth remembering is worth remembering because it is built on the foundation of Jesus Christ and it is invested in others. That's what it comes down to, isn't it? Isn't that part of the major portion of Jesus' teaching? Isn't that what he said? When they came to him and they said, Lord, tell us the greatest of the commandments. Rank them for us, will you please? Wouldn't we love for God to just do that? Tell me what sins are worse, Lord, and I'll avoid those. But tell me what ones are okay, and I'll go along with those. Tell me what rules are really important, and what ones are not. Well, Jesus obliged this man who asked the question. He said, it's this simple. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Do that, and you have not only fulfilled the law, you have fulfilled all the prophetic writings as well. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Build your life on Christ, and build your life on investing in others. You can't do it without both. That's the important aspect of all this that sometimes we miss. You can't just be a good guy or a nice lady and do good things. We're glad when you do. But because we want everyone to join us in heaven as well, you need to know Christ. And knowing Christ is a wonderful thing. But James says, if it doesn't change your behavior, then that knowing Christ is a dead faith. So it requires both. a life that is built on the foundation of Christ, and a life that is invested in others. Would you like your life to be worth remembering? You know, there's one person who is mentioned in all four Gospels, and she is the only person that Jesus Christ Himself said she's going to be remembered every time this Gospel is spoken. Remember? She's the lady that came in, and Jesus was sitting there at the table with a couple of pompous Pharisees, a few others, and they were doing what the men of the day did. They were sitting around the table enjoying the meal, and the ladies, in that day they were waiting on the men. And there was a woman who came in there who was of, shall we say, less than a noble reputation. And somehow she made her way in to this gathering. And when she did, she knelt at the feet of Jesus. And she had this jar of expensive perfume that would have taken her possibly as much as a year's wages to purchase. And she took that and she broke it. And she poured it at Jesus' feet. And she was weeping so profoundly that she wept tears on His feet and wiped them with her hair. Meanwhile, one of the more pompous members of the little male gathering there said, "What's the matter with him? If Jesus knew this woman's reputation, He'd stop her in a moment." And Jesus shut down the whole dinner party at that point. He said, "Listen, what she has done for me. She has worshipped extravagantly. She has demonstrated her love for me. And because of that, guess what? Every time the gospel is spoken of, every time it's recorded, every time people think of it, they're going to think of her and her extravagant act of worship." Do you want your life to be worth remembering? The Bible teaches us to number our days so that we may gain a heart of wisdom. That's in Psalm 90. In other words, live well. Enjoy your life. Have fun at it. Be sure that when you do leave this life, you have truly lived it. Don't leave anything undone. Along the way, put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ and enjoy the wonderful blessings of God. Worship Him at every opportunity. Never miss a chance to worship. Invest lavishly in others, generously, and give yourself freely and without reservation to those that you're privileged to love. Work hard, earn your living, so that you can support your family and help out those in need when you come across them. Do these things, and you will leave this world better than when you found it, and you will truly make your life.
Waiting for me to cross through. My heart is aching, I can't tell. So Lord, I'm begging for one last favor from you. Here's my heart, take it where you will. This life has shown me how we're mended and how we're torn. How it's okay to be lonely as long as you're free. Sometimes my ground was stony, sometimes covered up with thorns. And only you can make it what it had to be. And now that it's done, well, if they dress me like a pauper, or if they dine me like a prince, if they lay me with my fathers, or if my ashes scatter on the wind, I don't care. But when I leave, I'm gonna go out like Elijah, with the whirlwind of you, my chariot lit on fire. And when I look back on the stars, well, it'll be like a candlelight in Central Park. say goodbye. Oh,